I'll talk today about some of the research on education in conflict-affected countries, a little bit on health, and touch up on the labor market participation and one last project that we have on the impacts of armed conflict on attitudes and experiences of domestic violence. So as you're familiar with studies here, like the, I'm an economist, so we use an approach, like we use an empirical approach, and in studies that, in a set of studies that I looked at, that were education, human capital, and human capital, health, we test for investment in child under distress. And in most of the studies in the literature, in the empirical studies that try to understand what is the impact of conflict, there are number of studies that use differences and differences framework, where you compare children from the affected region and affected age group to similar children who live over a similar age group who were living in the region not affected by conflict, or who were older or younger. So they even actually kind of escaped the brunt of a conflict at all. So that's most of the studies that we use this approach, and we have to take them in this framework. And the population, many of the studies also use survey data, large public surveys collected by the World Bank or by USAID or other organizations, and combine them either with conflict data from large data sets, either studies like individuals collected their own data, or with victimization data from surveys themselves. So, and the first topic looks at education, and initially, it kind of ties well with, to the education session that we attended yesterday, some of us, and it evaluates the impact of conflict on quantity of education, as we initially started, and quantity measured by attending school individuals or going and completing a number of classes. And the impact has been pretty much uniformly negative, and the specific country-level impacts depend on the context, whether it's type of education considered, or I mean specific contextual impact of conflict, and I'll go over through a few impacts. And with quality of education, there was a set of studies that says, okay, conflict actually impacts the resources, because conflict-affected areas or schools, they don't get the resources, teachers flee those areas, and that impacts children directly. So the, like one of the first studies in this literature looked at on Tajikistan, and what I find there when that girls from conflict-affected areas and households, they completed less schooling and they were less likely to be enrolled at the time the conflict ended. And we explained that during the conflict there is a very sometimes it's difficult to go to school, but like due to concerns about safety. And girls from affected communities were less likely to go to school. And it could be also that families took an income consideration, that it's kind of an optional investment in a woman's education when she may not actually, most likely in the context of Tajikistan or Punjab, they wouldn't work and bring support families later on. So there are studies also that look at and find negative impacts for boys. For example, a study by Svi looking at Bosnia and Herzegovina finds that boys, young men lost in their education, and he explains by enlistments of men, young men, adolescent men in the army. When there are studies that say, okay, actually it's boys that the households kind of prioritize and sends them like, to get a job. And also, there is greater impact on boys' education in kind of, we lose more in education relative to girls in the situations where girls already had like very low education. So we barely were going to school and girls were achieving schooling. Boys were achieving a greater number of grades, but were taken out from school. So one of my favorite examples that looks at the contextual impact of conflict is when Christine Valentia looked at Maoist insurgency in Nepal. And she finds that actually it's one of a few countries where educational attainment and educational attainment of girls in particular has risen. And she explains it by kind of a focus of Maoists on bringing education to the less advantaged segments of population, in particular women. So that was one of the results of the paper. Another study says actually goes in more detail. And each study, since we all of them use survey data, we use all available data to them. So you may not be able to control for everything that you like, would like to control for. But Berwimp and Van Bavel, we were able to separate also poor and non-poor households' impacts. And what we find that in the context of Burundi, educational attainment of boys declines more than that of girls. But it's similar to Rwanda because boys were actually going to school, girls were not. So for girls, there was very little to lose in education. And poorer households, they took out both boys and girls out of schools. While wealthier households, they took out the boys because boys were actually were getting more education at the time. So there is a small set of studies that looks at the quality of schooling. And those studies, we explore the impact of different types of conflicts from Second Intifada to Palestine, like to low-level conflict in Turkey, and to drug-related crime in Brazilian favelas. And studies, we point out that test scores, we do decline in the schools and affected areas. And it matters if you're closer to reported violence, especially in like one of the kind of like most detailed studies is the last one on the slide, that we have like an excellent data and we were able to look at the radiuses of schools and how far each conflict event occurred. And what we find is that actually you would think that people would move in response to violence and try to take their children to different schools, but we find very little mobility. And most of the impact was through people not actually going to school due to this outburst of violence, which were kind of sporadic but frequent. And there was a big impact on school resources by teachers not coming to those areas. And in Turkey, for example, areas affected by Turkish Turkish-Kurdish conflict, they are unable to attract qualified teachers. Basically, teachers like they are allocated to those areas because of programs. They have to go for 1 year or two, but we leave immediately, so we do not stay. And educated professionals, we leave. So there is a kind of education gap, especially at the higher education and entry-level exams. So while for education, we find somewhat different results for both boys and girls, and it's context-specific. What I found interesting that for when we are looking at health, in particular measured by height for HZ scores, which are long-term determinant of health, the impact was very similar across countries, also in magnitudes and with respect to who is being affected. So children are being affected if they are of like this young age, under 5 years old, during the conflict. They lose, they're basically shorter than comparable children. And the impact is very similar between boys and girls, which should suggest that maybe those shocks are something that households were not prepared for. And Budervayet, Akresh, and Berwimp, they show actually it's very well in study because we compare two types of shocks. And they say that, like, with respect to crop shocks, households were clearly kind of withholding girls from school. Well, when the conflict started, it's everyone who lost schooling. And there is a large number of studies now, like, that exploring this impact. And thankfully, to this demographic and health service that collect good data on the subject. So I'll go over through one of the studies that we did with Camille Aminayou, kind of to go through a few details on the basic setup of a study and what the key results look like. So we used the 2002-2007 conflict in Côte d'Ivoire as a quasi-experiment to analyze its impact on child schooling. We ran a number of tests, trying to see, like, if our results withhold, like looking at the different subsamples, looking at the mortality and this of children, looking at the closeness to border and things like that. And we do find that there are negative and sizable impacts. And what this study was particularly, to me, like, interesting also because, like, we were able to look at two types of conflict level, like common shocks, which means that you lived in a municipality affected by conflict. And also the government of Côte d'Ivoire took sort of a great care and, like, we collected data on victimization among households right after the conflict ended. Not every country that went through the conflict does it. In some countries, we just, like, want to forget and not to talk about it. Here we collected fairly good information. So this is how a map in a particular study, each, pretty much every study of this would include a map that shows the regional distribution of conflict. And as we go move further, like, with quality increases because the quality of data has been increasing as well as the quality of programming. So we used here armed conflict events and location data set, which is collected by a group of researchers and has become, like, very large and popular to use. And we here, like, we combined, basically we counted the number of events in each locality. And we used with DACA areas representing more events and light areas, like, in more in the middle and to the side, the representing areas where the conflict didn't happen. So we used it as a yes or no variable in this basically equation where we use as a dependent variable height for each z-scores. And we particularly interested here in estimating the coefficient on this interaction between conflict region and child being in a VO cohort, meaning child was between ages like 0 and 5 years old. During the conflict time. So we compare them to children who either were born after the conflict or children who were reached age 5 before the conflict started, because we also have here before the conflict data. So, and we allow here, as most studies do, look at to interaction between female and conflict exposure to see if there is differential impact on females. So, forgive me if the table is too tiny, like the numbers, but the basic result is the top row with a coefficient on the conflict interaction between conflict child being in a conflict region and from affected cohort. And you see that in most of those cases, this interaction is negative. So we look at the different ways kind of measuring conflict here being, like, basically, were you alive during the war and you lived in the conflict-affected area? That would be columns 1 and 2. And then, and 7 and 8. And then 3 and 4, we look at the how many months. Does it matter how many months and at what age you were exposed? Is it, like, for younger children that we see great impacts or for older? And we do see great impacts for older children because if you're older, you lived in the conflict area for a longer period of time, so your deficit in height is greater. So that would be columns 3 and 4, and 9 and 10. And then 5 and 6, it's basically number of months in overall exposed to conflict. So I said this study had a pretty, the data had a good information on victimization, and we compiled this average index of victimization into one. For example, now like there is a kind of a movement by households and conflict network, and we published a paper trying to incorporate this victimization kind of model in all studies done in the post-conflict areas. So here we aggregated questions based on their meaning, like economic losses, health impairment, displacement, if a household was a victim of violence. So we separate by conflict region and non-conflict, and we see that pretty much uniformly there is a greater victimization reported in conflict areas, but you see also victimization being reported elsewhere as well. So which there is a spillover. It happens not only in that like dark shaded region, but also elsewhere as well. So that's the victimization map that looks a little bit different from what we saw before. And we do more maps and kind of look at the details. So here we just give one table results and we look at the differences between migrants and non-migrant households, full sample and non-migrant households. We actually find little impacts, little differences. So which, and Côte d'Ivoire was one of the studies that finds that you little differences between migrants and non-migrants. So display, like being displaced didn't impact child health as much or staying in the area. But victimization did have a large impact on height for age discourse. Here it's a cross-sectional survey, so we do not have really kind of a pre-conflict control group. So in this result, like we confirm results from my other studies. Children in conflict areas did experience setbacks, and the results are actually quite consistent between across the studies, even in the size of the impact. So, and in particular here, we find the mechanisms, because each study looks at mechanism. Yeah, we find this, okay, children are negatively affected, but what has driven those impacts? And we could say that migration didn't seem to matter in this particular case, but economic losses may have impacted child health. So I have maybe a couple of minutes to talk about other segments. So there are several studies looking at women, and women actually tend to, I mean, they may not go to school during the conflict, but they typically go to work. Those studies, like this study looks at, again, women who didn't get education during the conflict, but they seem to be more likely participating in the labor market after the conflict ended. So there is some substitution going on. And in Nepal and Colombia, women also step up. Once the conflict hits their families or households, they tend to take on jobs, in some cases, vacated by men, like so substituting for them in the labor market. Okay. So that's kind of a current project that is in progress now. And this study looks at the attitudes and experiences of women towards domestic, women and men towards domestic violence. And we match children from conflict-affected regions and countries in sub-Saharan Africa. It's a large cross-sectional data set. Like previous studies, most of them we were a case study type. And what we find is that we are able to look at men and women's attitudes, basically their acceptances of certain types of domestic violence, like one's beating a wife if she does X, Y, Z, let's say burns food, goes out without telling him, neglects children, and experiences of domestic violence by women. So what do we find is quite consistently that individuals who were exposed between age 6 and 10 to the conflict, they tend to report both greater acceptances of his domestic violence attitudes as well as experiences on the part of females of being experiencing domestic violence themselves. And men also report greater acceptances of those attitudes. But when we look at the data in terms of percentages, actually there is a greater acceptance percentage-wise for women than men. So which kind of is an encouraging result because, it's encouraging, but now I said also, it would be interesting for us like to analyze what is the discrepancy coming from. Is it coming from the norm? Okay. So yeah, and I'm done with the talk, and yeah, I'll let Markus to transition. Oh, so in the yeah. Thank you.